Love.
Good food.
Contradicting Catholicism.
Devotion.
See that, not the suburbs.
Home. Home is truly where the heart is. No matter where our lives took us, 881 Smith Street was always home for us. Smelling the good food, the conversations, the fellowship, and most of all, the love. That's home.
4237 Campbell Street felt more like home in the city than when my parents moved out to the suburbs. When you walk in the doors, there's crucifixes everywhere. I remember being about 8 years old, kneeling next to the bread with my hands together in prayer, feeling like something was missing. Only a few years later, I left the church in search of something more. Home.
Community.
Community.
Neighbors.
Front porches.
Freeze Man on Rockwell and the Candy Man on Welch.
The people we choose.
Feeding the hungry.
Community.
Community.
Man, I can remember going with my grandmother down the street to a neighbor whose son was sick. These people weren't in our family, but it was the sense of community and responsibility for each other. And I traveled with her to many of our neighbors that became like extended family. Being our brother's keeper, that was really the sense of community.
One spring afternoon, I was out organizing with my best friend and mentor, Warren, when it started pouring down rain. We ended up on the front porch of Senora Maria's house. She's a short, vibrant woman who doesn't speak a lick of English. And Warren is a tall, Jewish man who doesn't speak a lick of Spanish. I became their translator, entre dos mundos, really feeling between both worlds and grasping and pulling them together. Community.
Reunion. I think my granddaddy was really the one that pioneered the Pittsburgh reunion. When we were younger, he came out in the community with his own barbecue grill, spent his own money, bought food for the entire community to come and enjoy, to reunite, to fellowship, and to eat. And since then, the Pittsburgh reunion has grown into an amazing event. But yeah, I was there for the start of the Pittsburgh reunion from my granddaddy, Joseph Paul Dunson. Reunion.
A little less than 2 months ago, I arrived in Pittsburgh with my partner and best friend. I remember I couldn't wait to have our own space and to be in less than 500 square feet with somebody must mean you really love them. The weekend that we came here, we ended up at Pittsburgh Yards for a community event. And that's where I met Shannon and she invited us into this project. I don't really believe in irony. I thought it was meant to happen, from leaving the church and searching for something more, from realizing that I was always between two cultures, and now I had a little tiny front porch with my best friend and my cat, where we spent a lot of nights dancing and laughing and cooking food, making the whole kitchen smell like Indian food. This is now my home, where we could start new reunion.
The old original residents tenants of Pittsburgh McDaniel Street. This is where we would gather right here every morning. All of us that hung together, we would gather right here every morning. We wait till everybody get here, then we would take our track across the belt line. Mm-hmm. At that time, we didn't even know what it meant about the belt line. What was the belt line? It was just a word. We thought we associated it with the railroad track.
Yeah.
The railroad. And I think it was, who would come through it then? It wasn't officers.
Brown. Wasn't it Browning?
Well, all this was
the trucking company.
The trucking company was Great Southern at first.
Yeah. Uh-huh.
It was Great Southern. Then I think Brown brought them out and transformed this. This used to be a freight yard. I mean,
yeah.
freight, delivering freight on tractor trailers.
Yeah, and because the train track was here,
yeah,
where they would unload stuff off the box cars
right.
into the building,
and
the
then
building
the,
into the trucks.
And to the truck.
To the coal yard to get coal to keep the house heated, and she also cooked with coal. So we go up there maybe once a week, and we get these great big croaker sacks full of coal. And I would ride, she would pull me in the little red wagon. And we'd get to the coal yard, she'd pay for the coal, we'd load the coal, and not sit on the coal and ride all the way back to the house.
Yeah.
And then we built the fire and stuff, and she's the one that started me cooking too.
Yeah.
Cut through here, and for our science projects at school, we come over, it's a pond right over there, it used to be.
Yep.
And we go over there and we catch tadpoles and frogs and stuff for our little science classes, you know, and take them back to school, yeah. Every now and then we get a snake, you know, but snakes aren't cool, so not to us.
Yep.
That was one of my worst whoopings too, cause we came over one day and caught some frogs. And I still had one left in my pocket. And when my mama went to wash clothes, she reached her hand in my pocket and out jumped the frog. And that was another death row beating that I received.
really tore you up.
Yeah, she tore me up.
Those days, but that's, to me, that's when a neighborhood was neighborhood.
Mm-hmm.
Everybody knew each other. Everybody, all our parents knew each other's other parents' children.
Mm-hmm.
And it was just like really family orientated.
Oh yeah.
Uh-huh.
You know? And if it came up and it was time to eat and you was over to your friend's house, they had to move over because you was going to eat too.
Yeah.
Everybody
oh,
ate
yeah.
it. Every,
yeah.
They made sure we were fed.
Yeah, well we didn't know anything. Our parents didn't know anything but hospitality back then.
Mm-hmm.
Because they all had to group together and support each other.
Uh-huh.
Yeah, because, you know, we couldn't go downtown.
Yeah, well, we didn't need to go downtown for anything because we had doctors, lawyers,
yeah.
we had our own
right,
grocery stores, we everything.
Right,
you remember the filling station that we
yeah.
Had up there?
Yeah, yeah.
By the railroad track.
Right, mm-hmm. right there, Berkeley and McDaniel.
Yeah, right.
Uh-huh. You know, that's
yeah. Dry cleaners.
We had all that.
Yeah,
yeah we had.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I mean, black businesses then.
Oh yeah.
And they supported each other.
Mm-hmm.
Because we, like I said, we couldn't go downtown, so we had to confine ourselves right there in the Pittsburgh area.
Yeah, right. Uncles, they were against integration because they said it was going to destroy
but it did.
The black community.
It did.
And our businesses that we had.
It did.
Mm-hmm.
I remember before we could go downtown. When I moved back here from New York,
mm-hmm.
went to work with old Pascal Brothers.
Mm-hmm.
Pascal Brothers was fine. King, all them, all the mass meeting that the civil rights leaders planned right there at Pascal.
Pascal, right, yeah. On Hunter Street.
On Hunter Street.
Mm-hmm.
Everything was right there on Hunter. Clark College, Spelman, Marsh Brown, Atlanta University, all
right,
together
right there
mm-hmm. at Pascal. That was when, as soon as they integrated downtown and said we could come downtown, all the civil rights people, civil rights leaders, they left Pascal.
Mm-hmm.
Went to the Marriott. Marriott was the first all white.
Uh-huh.
That yeah. allowed us to come down
there. Yeah, right.
And when we were closed, Pascal, the restroom was closed like 10 or 11, but the lounge stayed open to 2 o'clock.
Mm-hmm.
And we all would get off from work and go down to the Marriott.
Mm-hmm.
You know?
Yeah.
All the blacks start going downtown to Marriott, left Pasco. Mm-hmm. Pasco should have been a historical landmark, yeah, right now.
Yeah, it should be, yeah.
Mm-hmm. Right now. That's, yeah, where all of the mass meeting were planned, right there. And look what happened. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Blacks were able to go downtown and mingle with the Caucasian. Mm-hmm. Black business suffered.
Yeah.
Integration was good in a sense. Mm-hmm. But it destroyed the bonding.
Yeah.
The bonding among black families and black, you know.
Yeah.
So like, I mean, when I moved back here and moved way out. Mm-hmm. I was put there. I was there 12 to 15 years. They didn't know my neighbors.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Right.
You know, we would see each other, come in the evening, hit the remote, mm-hmm, garage door go up,
never
you go
did.
In. You don't see them anymore. Mm-hmm. And the next morning, after overnight sleeping, the next morning we get up and leave, come out, go on the way to work. Mm-hmm. You raise your hand and wave at your neighbor, but you never got to know.
Between McDaniel and Hubbard Street, no, there was an alleyway all the way through up to the railroad, wasn't it?
Yep.
Mm-hmm.
Yep.
Yeah, we didn't have to really get on the sidewalks and stuff, because that was really our playground until we started going over to Pittman Park.
Yeah, but that's, yeah, and that's, mm-hmm, that's when we really used to have rock throwing fight.
Yeah. Yeah, uh-huh. Yeah.
The guys from that were raised up on the Fletcher Street side over there by W.A. Cromwell, where,
yeah,
we all went to, mm-hmm, elementary school. They stayed up like on the hill.
Yeah, right. So,
mm-hmm. And we stayed
in the valley.
Yeah,
really.
So Pippa Paul was like just like this.
Yeah, it was.
Yeah, uh-huh. Fletcher was over here, and then the park was down here. Mm-hmm. And we were getting rock battle with the guys that stayed on the Fletcher Street side. And we, mm-hmm, yeah, we used,
oh,
to have,
yeah, we had, uh-huh,
rock battle. Yeah.
Oh yeah. Mm-hmm.
And I could. Then we end up making our own man-made slingshot.
Oh yeah. Uh-huh. Yeah. Yeah. The slingshot. Yeah.
We made them slingshot. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Yeah. But those were the good old golden days. I tell you.
And to keep from getting hit by the rocks, we used to take our garbage can tops and use them as a shield. Pow.
Yeah.
You know.
Yeah. Yeah, we got that.
We
got that from the Romans.
Yeah. Uh-huh.
They
had shields.
We got that from the Romans. Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
I was born in the Pittsburgh community in 1957. I attended elementary school here at W.H. Cromwell. Had my first fist fight up here in this school. Pittman Park, which is a block away, has always been the heart and soul of this neighborhood. That's where we did sports, general recreation, and just generally chill out. Pittsburgh community has always been a Christian neighborhood, except on Friday, Saturday nights. That's when the devil came in, but he had to leave on Sunday morning. I left the neighborhood in 1971 because my mother got a decent paying job at the VA hospital. I moved to the Decatur neighborhood. That's why I attended Decatur High School. I graduated from Decatur High School in 1975. After that, I joined the U.S. Navy. In the Navy, I've been to quite a few places, been around the world. We moved back to the neighborhood in 1983 because I had an aunt that we left over here. She got Alzheimer's, and she was hard for her to stay by herself. So we moved back in 1983, and I've been here ever since. This has always been my home. Hopefully, this is where I'll die.
Hello? Well, I'm leaving Pittsburgh. Let me tell you why. It's because of the gentrification that I've seen going on all around me. My daughter and I moved to Irish Street 3 years ago, and within 6 months, I've seen two families move. And during the process of seeing all this gentrification, it came to our household. The homeowner sold his house and we also have to move. During the process of house hunting, we've run across scammers, realty companies, and so-called homeowners that are charging $45 to $75 per adult for application fees. It's sad what they're doing. But I still hold the memories from Pittsburgh, and that's seeing the guys around the barrel of fire warming in the wintertime. I had never seen anything like this before except on TV, and to see it across the street was amazing. They would also volunteer to help with our groceries. Then the other memories I have is of Anne. She was a homeless person that made sure our streets stayed clean. We all would give her money, food, and clothing. Rest in peace, Anne. And then there's not so good memories of Pittsburgh, and that's when we had to hit the floor because of gunshots and bullets flying through our house. We even had our power knocked out because the bullets came through the walls. And recently, we didn't even know it was a bullet in our kitchen above the microwave. So those mixed feelings, I will try not to remember, but I will not forget. I'm leaving Pittsburgh, but I hope to return to see the change and development. We move tomorrow.
My name is Sheena, and I think it was destined for me to be here in Pittsburgh. I'm originally from Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania, where all the trains and the smut in the fall told me to go try to find a place on Garibaldi Street. I went on Garibaldi Street, I got me a place, and I noticed all the Pittsburgh Steelers stuff around. And I was like, y'all like the Steelers this much? They said, no, you in Pittsburgh. I say in Pittsburgh. They said you in Pittsburgh, Atlanta. I couldn't believe it. Something brought me right back here. Learning about this area, I found out that this was a very historical area for black businesses once. And that really inspired me to be in the neighborhood. Even though I felt at home, the home that I had, even though I was grateful for it, it was not the best home in town. I was actually a little bit ashamed of it. I didn't invite company over, and even when Ubers would drop me off, they would be like, are you sure you want to get dropped off here? So although I know I love the neighborhood, I had to make a change. And when I saw a new development building, I got very interested. I clicked on the website and noticed that they had apartments, and I signed right up. And I felt like this was my opportunity to just, you know, start to feel like I'm living that walk into Atlanta life. And I applied, and 2 years later, they called me back. I was actually the first resident here in this big, beautiful building. I used to have mimosas and do yoga by myself in the morning. Moving into this place, it just felt so grand, such a transition to where I was and where I am now. I get the vibe with a ton of entrepreneurs, and as an entrepreneur myself, it gives me much more confidence in my business and much more confidence to help people that are just starting their business. My goal for living in Pittsburgh and being at the Pittsburgh Yards is for the entrepreneurship to spread from outside of the Pittsburgh Yards to McDaniel Street so we can make this a thriving black community as it once was.
With my mom, my dad, my grandma. I've lived in metro areas, in small areas. I've lived in America and Japan. I've lived in multicultural neighborhoods. I've lived in melanin-dominated neighborhoods and neighborhoods devoid of melanin. But I moved to the Pittsburgh community in 2017, and it was right around the time where the shooter of Philando Castile was acquitted. So the cultural climate was pretty tense at the time. Now fast forward to 2020, and that tension had escalated even more, because after that we had had the deaths of Breonna Taylor, Sandra Bland, Ahmaud Arbery, and George Floyd. But when it really hit close to home was when Rayshard Brooks was shot up at the Wendy's right off of University Avenue, right up the street. It was so close to home that I could stand out on my porch and smell the smoke and the flames from where the protesters had burned down the Wendy's. And it's almost as if that smell was summoning me. So I decided one day to just go over there and take a look. And when I got there, I saw the devastation, the ashes and the burning, and I began to feel these emotions welling up in me that were familiar but hadn't been around for some years. It was feelings of hurt and fear and perplexity and feeling like you don't belong and feeling like an outsider. And let me tell you a little about where those feelings came from. When I was small, I lived with my single mother, and we were the only black family in the neighborhood, and we were not treated very well. My sister and I were peeling toilet paper out of our trees almost every weekend where they would roll our yard. We had a cross burned in our yard. When I was about 5 years old, I was getting ready to go to bed, I looked out my window and there was a man dressed in a devil costume. Sure, it was meant to scare me, and he was successful because I was scared. But then we moved to another neighborhood, and we again were the only African-American family in the neighborhood. And same thing, I had a friend with a swimming pool who let us, me and my sister, swim in their pool. And the neighborhood called an intervention with her mother, threatening her if she ever let black kids swim in that pool again. And ironically, there was a family that lived right across the street, and their last name was King. But when I asked if I could play with their kids, the mother said, no, ask their father. And I asked the father, he slammed the door in my face. So yeah, so those weren't really the best of memories. But when I lived with my grandma, it was a totally different type of neighborhood and community. The people were very warm. Everybody knew each other. Everybody knew everybody's names. Everybody knew each other's kids' names. And they were very resourceful, and they helped each other. No matter what one neighbor had, the other neighbor needed it, they helped. We had the candy lady up the street. We had the meat man down the street. We even had one of our neighbors who drove the ice cream truck. And when kids would come running out of the house to the ice cream truck, whatever parent had money that day is the one that came out and bought all the ice cream for the kids. And my grandma was the one that baked the cakes for the neighbor. And she had this huge garden, and she would make herbs, and she'd pluck her fruits and herbs and make medicines and give it out to the neighbors. So it was a very different type of community. I moved to Georgia. It was during a time when they would have the Atlanta murdered and missing children. And even though it was a really dark time, there actually was a bright spot in that it was a time where the neighbors began to start looking out for their kids again. When they'd look out the windows, look out the doors, they weren't just looking for their kids. They were very intentional about making sure every child made it home safe. And when I start thinking also about hopefulness, it reminds me of my seventh grade teacher, Ms. Young. In my community, we didn't have a bus that would take us to school. We had to walk a really long ways. I lived in a predominantly African-American neighborhood at the time. One day, we were all walking to school, and it was just thundering and storming, and it was muddy and rainy, and we showed up at school with just mud all the way up to our knees and all of our clothes, and we were soaked to the bone, and she just looked at us in disgust. Now, let me remind you, this was a little short, petite white lady, and she was sweet as pie, but she was also tough as nails. And her hair was graying, but I think it was graying a little earlier than her age because she was also a chain smoker. So this particular day, she was so upset. We had never seen her that upset. She threw her pack of cigarettes on the desk and ran out the classroom. We were like, where in the world did she go? She came back She said, you will have a school bus to pick you up tomorrow. And there was. And for the rest of the year, there was a school bus. But needless to say, I love that teacher. But that wasn't the only reason why I loved her. Another thing was the first day of school, she asked me, she said, what do you want to be called? And I said, huh? She said, well, I heard your mom calling you Kim, but your records say your first name is Victoria. So what do you want to be called? And I said, well, my teachers have always said, that's your first name. That's what we're going to call you. You don't have a choice. And she said, oh, no. Oh, no. You have a choice. And she said, and you should never let anybody define who you are. And that really stuck with me. And I want Pittsburgh Yards, the community, I want us to choose to be a diverse community that appreciates all the different, all of what that brings creatively, but also I want us to be one that appreciates diversity, appreciates the traditions, warm neighborhood, driven by humanity. Go back to the Wendy's where there was ashes and rubble and destruction. And I stopped, and I stopped before I got too caught up in that emotion, I looked over in contrast and saw flowers and gifts and tributes and graffiti affirming humanity. And I thought to myself, we should make a choice here. We can either choose hope or we can choose hopelessness. And I think about the type of future that I want Pittsburgh community to have. I want it to be a community of hope.
The moment that changed my life, and I had no idea that that was going to happen or be that pivotal moment, came out to Pittsburgh Yards Community Market one Saturday to support a friend who had started a coffee business. And I had no idea that going somewhere for what I thought was one purpose would actually lead to something else that was life-changing. Ended up meeting the property manager here at Pittsburgh Yards, and he invited me in for a tour the following week. And I came in, and the moment I walked in to the building here at Pittsburgh Yards, I knew that this was a place that I wanted to be in, a place that I wanted my business, Frugal Chicks Rock, to have as a home. I thought I was coming here just to support my friend, but really, there was so much more that would happen. The name of my business is Frugal Chicks Rock, and at the time, it was a women's online boutique. I did a lot of sales on social media and on my website, and of course, popping up and doing vending events at places all over Metro Atlanta. Well, when I came to Pittsburgh Yards and took that tour, and felt the sense of community and knew that this was a place I wanted to be in, that really allowed me to take my business to the next level because I now had a home to invite my clients to have events. And everything about Pittsburgh Yards was just so inviting. And I can't say it enough, it was life-changing. This place that has always been a part of Pittsburgh has been transformed into an entrepreneurial hub, a place to do business, a place to call home, a place to feel welcome, from the fixtures in the building, just everything about this space, this place, is connecting community and business. So I'm so thankful to be here. And I'm here with Bridget, who has also had that life-changing moment.
Yes, in 2019, there was a flood at Grady Hospital. I just happened to be there that day. And it was a life-changing situation where everyone was running and trying to get to the top of the building because the flood was coming from the bottom of the floor. A pipe had busted, and they were trying to rush us to go upstairs to the highest part of the hospital. During the process, I fell And when I got to the top of the ninth floor, I was on a stretcher. And there were doctors all around me and everything. So the next couple of days, they put me in a bed in a room, and I was diagnosed with cancer. This threw me for a loop because that's something that I've heard about on TV, I've seen on TV. So it was just terrifying to me. But 2 weeks ago, I went to the doctor and they told me that I was cancer free. So I'm a survivor of cancer. And I'm just glad and happy to know that if that situation probably hadn't happened, I wouldn't know that I was in stage three, because when you get to stage four, there's nothing they can do for you. And I'm also a native of Pittsburgh. I was born in Pittsburgh in 1958. So, you know, that was a moment in my life that I just couldn't grasp at first, but now I know things change and you never know what's gonna happen each day. I met Niota through coming up to the marketplace, and I found out that she was a vendor, and I was also a vendor in the West End Mall area. So I know what it is to pack your stuff up and pack it in boxes and put it in your car and struggle trying to put your tent up and all kind of crazy stuff, you know, wind blowing stuff, and you got to chase behind it and everything. So I'm just happy to be here, and I'm happy to see entrepreneurs trying to make it happen.
Know that for you, you have also thrived in the midst of all of this, right?
Yes, yes, I've grown a lot and learned a lot. And I'm just thankful to be here.
School right here.
Oh, okay.
I have some great memories of this school. My first memory was in the kindergarten. I had two teachers, Miss Ray and Miss McLean. I just remember one day it was pouring rain and we were getting ready to leave the classroom, and they both were helping me put on my rain gear. I had some big red galoshes. They were big like clown shoes that my little feet just slid right down into them. I felt so loved and safe and protected with them making sure that I would be out of the elements of the rain. And my friends and I would love to come to school for Miss Ray and Miss McLean to see about us, to take care of us away from home. So I grew up with those same friends, and we'd walk home from school together in the rain. But I think we took that for granted. We took our friendship for granted. We thought we'd always be here. We thought we'd always be in the neighborhood. We thought we'd always be around each other, walking home from the store or whatever. I know that you just moved into this neighborhood. Have you found any kind of connection or bond like that? Friendship, family, protection in this neighborhood?
I wouldn't say that I found that yet. When I moved in, we were still pretty deep into the height of the pandemic, so it really wasn't the best time to meet new people, per se. But I know in the time that I've been here, there have been so many changes to the neighborhood that I've been aware of. It's almost like a new place, in a sense. And so one thing that I could do during the pandemic was just walk, and that was what led to me being able to see all that. New houses going up, new renovations going up, and it was really hard to keep track of all of it while I was going on my walks. It could be one month the street looked one way, and then the next month it was almost like a new street, different houses getting redone, which was great, but in a sense it was like a little bit concerning, because as you go through the neighborhood, you occasionally see signs talking about people being concerned about gentrification, which makes a lot of sense, because just in the year that I've been here, I've seen my own tax rates go up by about 61%. So I wasn't super surprised, but that is still a big amount. So one thing that did happen while I was walking through the neighborhood is I met this lady named Crystal who just greeted me while I was on a walk and invited me to come down to the grand opening of her friend's new smoke shop. And I told her I would go, so I did. And it was really great. I'm not really somebody who smokes, but I found some sweet potato chips there and I went ahead and bought those because that was something that worked for me and I really wanted to just support a local Black woman-owned business in the neighborhood. So I think that's one thing that I could say is some form of community for me, the sense of supporting people within my community, especially when they reach out for it.
We had that growing up. Mm. We had the village. We had this place that the adults took care of the children, mm-hmm. the adults disciplined the children, whether they were your parent or a neighbor or just an adult in this community. Mm. Was that Lady Crystal part of the community? I knew a lot of people in Pittsburgh, but I didn't know everybody. So was she already a fixture here or is she just moving here?
Well, she's definitely been here since before I got here. And I always remembered going by her house because it was so pretty and the color was so bold, especially with the door. They were just really bold, vibrant blues and yellows. And I thought that just looks so good because not everybody has the guts to go hard on color, especially on your whole house.
Yeah. And we had fun times together. We went to Pittman Park together. We were in that swimming pool every day of the summer. We played basketball. My brothers played football and we learned how to play football. It was just a sense of family, connection, friends, loving one another, people that cared about each other, people that looked out for one another. And when people start to move away, it made us sad because we realized things were changing. People were looking for something, if not better, something different. At this very moment, I want to be in this neighborhood. I just want to be here and meet and greet the new people that are moving here. Have that sense of connection with them and have that sense of family bonding with the new people, no matter who they are. I want it to be a neighborhood of tolerance and acceptance, and I would love to see finances coming into this community that could help the people that are over here who can't afford to build their houses up or remodel their houses or fix their houses up. I would like to see funding for this community for projects that could help the people that are still over here and have been here the whole time.
In real estate, I'm your guy, the realtor, Brandon. That's me. I'm a realtor. I moved to Pittsburgh Yards in 2010 with the want or the need. I couldn't make it to New York, so Atlanta was my place. I actually ran across a building, a old warehouse building, and little did I know that was going to be my apartment for the next 13 years. When I walked into the space, the exposed brick, the exposed beams just gave me the feel that I've always wanted. I wanted to live in a loft. I wanted to live in a building that used to be a warehouse, and I got exactly what I needed. It took me back to my childhood. I walked outside and saw the people, the neighborhood, the community, and was like, I am here. Little did I know about Pittsburgh, and little did I know that it was going to be my home. When I became a realtor, I decided, let me utilize my realtor skills to get some of these vacant houses sold and this vacant land sold and help my community bring back the economic development that needed to be here. And before I knew it, the opportunity kind of slipped away. I started to sell all over Georgia, but I also knew that I still had to give an impact or give my seeds back to my community. So instead of selling my community, I sell all over the state of Georgia, but I live right here in Pittsburgh. I plant seeds and grow in the community. I like to give back to this community by way of providing services to the garden, also cleanup, giving a helping hand wherever is needed. And so that has allowed me to give back and also invest my time back into a community that I have grown to love, and also let people know who have been here before that they deserve to stay here. That also led me to a wonderful, wonderful woman who has taught me so much about life and so much about giving back and planting things, because when you plant them, they will grow. Pittsburgh is a garden and we all are seeds. So the next person I'll be introducing you to is the garden queen, Queen Haleen.
So, I'm very happy for you to say that, because to start a garden, it takes healthy seeds in healthy soil, produces healthy food for healthy you. I came to Pittsburgh Yard with the intention that I would produce food for the community, with the community, to alleviate poverty through sustainability. I was born in Jamaica in a family of farmers, five generations of farmers. My grandfather, my father, they all grew to sustain the family, friends and neighbors. I saw the vision for Pittsburgh. I came in and I could not find a supermarket or a health food store. And just like I did in the West End for over 35 years, I came in with the intentions of, I'm going to change this. The climate in Atlanta is too good to be wasted. And thankfully, the Annie E. Casey Foundation saw it fit to lease me this piece of property so that I could plant an urban garden where the community would take part and we all could grow to sustain ourselves. My vision for the future is that as many people in this community would take a piece of plot of land or some containers, and if they don't know, I'll teach them, because I know how to garden. I know how to farm. I have a saying, nursing is my passion, printing is my trade, but farming is in my DNA. And planting and growing and reaping is what I do best and enjoy it. Come to this garden for your garden therapy. We could open stores. We could plant different things. Each one plant something different and then we share. And eventually we could have a large warehouse where the complete community would be able to sustain themselves and never have to go to a regular supermarket for their produce. How would you like to plant in your own garden? You are right, Brandon, very right. We are a garden, a beautiful garden, and all of us are seeds. Come on and let's grow together. Pittsburgh.
moved here from Kansas City, Missouri not too long ago. And it wasn't the first time being in Pittsburgh, in your community. Mm-hmm. I'd actually been here once before when I was exploring Atlanta to see if this was a place that I wanted to move. Mm-hmm. And I knew in that time that Pittsburgh, for whatever reason, more than any of the other neighborhoods that I got to drive through on that initial visit, felt like home. What I mean by that is, it felt like where I had come from. And so I knew that if I chose to move to Atlanta, which I eventually did, I knew that I would be moving into Pittsburgh. So once we moved down to Pittsburgh, I wanted to go out and take some photos of my new neighborhood. One of the best ways to get to know a new place is to see it through a lens. And so I grabbed my camera and I walked up and down Pryor and I was taking some shots. I took shots of the Beltline, I took shots of the All-American Package Store, I took shots of a whole bunch of things. And as I was walking towards the intersection of University and Pryor, there was a man who had come out of the auto parts store. And he was walking up to his white Escalade truck with his rims. He was looking good. And he looked down at me from the hill that he was on. And I said, "How you doing, sir?" He said, "I'm fine, youngin', I'm fine." And then after a pause, he looks back at me and he goes, "Hey, be safe out here." And that was a strange thing to hear in that moment. I had an interesting reaction to it because in that moment, that made Pittsburgh feel even more like home, because that's what we would say to each other. But that "be safe" phrase has so many connotations, doesn't it?
It does.
Yeah, and it could be a gift that somebody is giving you. It could also be a wish that you'll come back, but it could also be a threat depending on where you're at.
Exactly.
And so I was thinking in that moment, what does he believe about the neighborhood that I just moved into? What does he believe about where I came from? And I wanted to ask you, have you all always told each other to be safe in Pittsburgh, or has it evolved over time?
Well, to answer your question, yes, it has evolved over time. I've been in this area for over 70 years, so I had the joy of the privilege of seeing it grow from an historically black community that was very much family oriented to a period of not so much growth, and then a period of drugs and lawlessness taking over Pittsburgh. But, and I say the joy, because I've seen it rise from the ashes, and that's where we are now. We are rising from the ashes, and I don't know if we'll ever, ever see those glory days that I experienced as a child, but we most definitely are on the right path. We are embracing our future with new people like you, that are coming from other, bringing your own life experience into the mix of things. And that's how you grow. I welcome the new housing, the affordable houses that they are constructing now. I welcome new people into our community. But at the same time, I want to make sure that the people that are already here, that have been here for years, like my family, are not priced out of their homes. So I want to see, in embracing the future, the new and the old will come together and form a fist of encouragement. Jay, you know, community is built in spirit and in truth. And what we say will linger in our ears long after the words have been spoken. So we should, the words we use with each other have power.
They do. So instead of "be safe," what's something that we can tell each other?
think we should say be courageous.